He said, "Man, how do you listen to this stuff? It's really scary." And I said, "You know, I know the end, right? I know how this all ends."
He brought to my attention was the regathering of Israel. It's very possible that the end time scenario can be triggered because they are regathered into the land. That's one of the prerequisites for the second coming.
That's one thing I don't understand. The book of Revelation is the only book in the Bible that promises a blessing to those who read it. So why isn't it largely being studied? You know, it's the back of the book. It's the end of the story. It's Christ's victory. Why is this book so highly ignored?
Good morning! How is everyone on this steamy July day? It's a good day for a pool party. We'll go ahead and get started here. We'll look at some prophecy in the headlines. There's some good ones for this week. This is from BreakingIsraelNews.com. Leading Israeli rabbi says that the arrival of the Messiah is imminent. Once again, we're going to start seeing as things speed up in the Middle East, as we talk about wars and rumors of wars and things like that, even those in the Jewish religion are beginning to notice all the signs. And leading Israeli rabbis over and over again are now saying that they believe that the arrival of the Messiah is going to happen any day. Now remember that Jews today, living in the land, they missed the fact that Jesus was their Messiah. Okay, Jesus already came, the true Messiah. So unfortunately, a majority of the Jews in the land today are going to have a mistaken identity. They are going to accept the Antichrist as this Jewish Savior. And we'll look more at that when we start getting into the wars of the book of Revelation. But you guys are going to see, I personally believe that there is going to be some wars in the Middle East. And I even think that somebody will kind of deliver Israel through some wars, and they're going to see this guy as a messianic figure. But anyways, that just with all the things that are going on in the world, even the very Orthodox Jews believe that their Messiah is on his way. That Messiah that we know from Scripture would be the Antichrist. He wouldn't be the real Jesus, because we know that he's going to come after the end of the tribulation. So that's an interesting headline. Also from the Times of Israel, Egypt's leader, his name is General al-Sisi, said that ending the Israeli-Palestine conflict would stabilize the Mideast. So once again, we got to keep paying attention as they continue to discuss this Israeli-Palestine land rift. Many people believe that if we can somehow solve this problem, create a two-state solution, that there will be peace in the Middle East. Now, we obviously hold a different view from that. We think if you take Israel out of the Middle East, it wouldn't stabilize anything. But long story short, it's just important for us to pay attention that these guys are all about negotiating covenants and land treaties, trying to figure out how they can create an Israeli-Palestine state. I'm not saying that this is leading to what we know as the seven-year covenant that we describe in the book of Daniel. Because remember that what's going to start the seven-year tribulation period is a peace covenant that the Antichrist is going to enforce upon Israel and surrounding areas. So I'm not necessarily saying that this is going to be it when describing this Israeli, this Palestine peace negotiation, but it looks like at least a pattern or a type of this peace negotiations, these covenants that are coming. So it's just important for us to pay attention to that. And by the way, I don't think that if ending this Israeli-Palestinian conflict will stabilize the Mideast, because unfortunately, as we've discussed multiple times, Islam is a theocracy, which means they are a state and a church, and they have in their holy writings that they want to take over the whole world through their religion. So unfortunately, until we handle that issue, there will be no peace in the Middle East. Finally, the Pope, this is from Fox News, he wrapped up his Ecuador leg of South America trip after calling for a new ecological and economic order. Every time you guys hear the words in the news, new world order or new economic order, it's important for us to pay really close attention to that. especially coming from what the world sees as the face of Christianity, that being the Pope. I'm not going to get into the specifics of any of this. Once again, I just want you guys to pay attention to this, but the Pope is basically trying to unite the world through any means necessary. And we, when we read the book of Revelation, we see this unity, this one world religion, this one world economy, this one world stuff that's coming is bad, right? It's going to be formed by the Antichrist. So we see that as bad. So once again, just pay attention to these headlines. Things seem to be escalating, ramping up. What role will the Pope play in the future with any of this stuff? We don't know, but we can just watch with the, looking at it through the lens of Scripture. So it's just important for us to pay attention to. So real quick review of what we covered last week. And as we stated, we're in the letter to the church at Pergamos. So every one of these seven letters, Jesus literally wrote to these seven churches, but they are also written to us today because these letters were supposed to be dispersed among all the churches. So we know that every letter was also written to us. So we're applying what we learned from these to our Christian walks. So what we looked at was Jesus told this church at Pergamos that we would receive new names. And we looked at how that goes along with us getting that white stone. He described to the overcomers getting a white stone. That means we're found not guilty. We looked at the ancient Roman adoption on how basically when you were adopted into a new family in ancient Rome, your past was forgotten. All the bad was forgotten. And you also became heir of this new family's fortune or whatever they have. That's a picture of us in Jesus Christ. We are adopted into the family of God. So we also are heirs. We will receive the blessings of the Father through Jesus. We also saw during this time in church history from around the year 300 AD to 600 AD that Satan quit persecuting the church. He kind of allowed peace and prosperity. So instead, Satan switched tactics where he switched to internal corruption. When we found that through the teachings of Balaam, through different ways to get people to internally be corrupted. And last week we looked at how that had infected the American church. For instance, the fact that only, was it 15% of mainline Christians say that Jesus Christ is the only way to salvation. It was either 15 or 18%. So what that means is one or two out of 10 Christians in the mainline megachurches would say that Jesus Christ is the only way to salvation. We know from God's holy word that Jesus Christ is the only way. He says in John 14 that I am the way, the truth, and the life. So once again, what we've seen is we've seen these kind of ideas of the world blend with the church that just don't mix. So that's where we're seeing all these different internal corruptions. The church no longer prays. The church no longer has biblical views on homosexuality, things like that, etc. So we're going to continue to see this internal corruption. Finally, we were at the final point where we're looking at forced conversion versus internal repentance. So remember that when Constantine made Christianity the state religion, what you began to see was forced conversion, or basically you're born into this Christian state, and if you don't go along with the rules of the state, you're out, okay? So we're looking at that. We're looking at the difference between forced conversion versus internal repentance. And forced conversion doesn't go along with the gospel. Jesus says that he wants men to repent, and we're going to look at that right here. So let's get into some new material. We'll have Derrik pray, and we'll get started here.
Thank you for this day, Father. We just pray that your Holy Spirit will fill us today as Chuck goes over this lesson. Just bless him, speak through him as we go over and hopefully finish Christ's letter to Pergamos. And Father, we thank you for our brother T. Hood as he recovers. Thank you for keeping him safe. We just pray that he can be miraculously healed and be out here hopefully by next week, if not sooner. And we just pray all these things in your name. Amen.
Amen. Let's see what time it is. All right. Plenty of time to finish Pergamos today. Okay, so this was the slide we kind of left on. It's important for us to realize it's not enough to be born a Christian. Guys, just because our parents are Christians, just because we live in a Christian nation, America, that doesn't get us into heaven, right? A personal relationship accepting the blood of Jesus is what gets us into heaven. At one point in American history, 80 to 90% of all Americans claimed to be Christians. Now, they don't necessarily know what that means, but that's just important for us to see that it's not enough just to be born in America and have this state church mentality that just because I'm here in the land, in the promised land, the blessed land of America, that I'm automatically got a free ticket to heaven. Jesus didn't set up a theocracy. As I described, what Islam is, it's considered a theocracy. A theocracy is where you're combining politics and church. You're forcing basically a church on a political system. That's what Islam is. That's why they believe they have to subjugate the world to the Sharia law, to the dictates of the Quran. Jesus didn't set that up. Jesus commanded the disciples, or the apostles, to go make disciples of all nations. A disciple is someone who wants to learn. A disciple is someone who's being taught things. We're not ever forcing discipleship. God wants us that internal conversion. Notice that next bullet. You can't force a partner to love you. We live in what's known as the age of grace. I don't necessarily like that terminology because basically all of human history is an age of grace. But this is a special age of grace. The last 2,000 years, where all we've had to do to be accepted into the family of God is trust in what Jesus did on the cross. And that's a miracle. It's so simple, right? It's just simple faith in Jesus, and you're saved, you're sealed, and you're going to heaven. So that's an age of grace. But what I want you to get is that's a choice. We can't force that on anyone. I can't force other people to become Christian. It has to be an internal conversion of the heart. And this is contrary to, believe it or not, what a lot of people within the church do. They actually believe that we can force Christianity on people, and we'll kind of see that play out here. The actual, even the word repentance, when you're reading the Bible, you see the word repentance over and over and over and over again. The word repentance actually literally means, so you're walking one way, it's kind of a picture, you turn around, okay? You stop, you do 180, and you turn around. It's like you're walking away from God, or you have a mindset that's against God. You literally change your mind and you walk back. That's kind of the picture of repentance. And it's important for us to realize that that requires free will. That requires a decision. So once again, you can't force someone to repent. I can't force somebody to be sorry for their sins. I can't force somebody to accept what Jesus did on the cross. And this will all make sense as I tie this together here. Also, 5 out of the 7 churches in Revelation were required to repent, to change their mind. It's important for you guys to realize I'm not just going over this stuff for fun. It will play out. I believe in a pre-tribulational rapture. I think we'll be out of here before the 7-year tribulation. But just so you guys know, there will be a forced state church in the future of this world. There will be a one world religion that is forced upon the world. You either go by this forced state religion or you're chopped. Your head's off, right? So it's important for us to kind of gain this concept of combining state and church, because when we get further down the road here in Revelation, we're going to see this state church play out. It is coming in the future. And here's a hairy question, and it's kind of interesting. We just celebrated the 4th of July, and I don't want to come off as unpatriotic because I want you guys to understand I love America. I love our freedoms. I stand for the good that America does, but I want to differentiate some things, because if we're not careful, patriotism can actually become a form of idolatry, and I want to explain that real quick. So were we a Christian nation? And as I said, that's a hairy question. When Barack Obama took office at the beginning of his presidency, he said, "We are no longer a Christian nation." What's interesting is I actually agree with him, and you have to be really careful and we don't know the exact context of what he was explaining there, but one could argue that we've never been a Christian nation. There's great people who break this down when you really describe your terms and hash all this out, that we actually would never be considered a Christian nation. Now, the question is, do we want to be a Christian nation? Okay, and we have to really, really differentiate what we mean by that. Do we want to be a Christian nation in terms of, do we want a majority of people to be Christians and to be following the Bible and to be following Jesus? Absolutely. We would love for a majority of all the country to be repentant and to be following Jesus wholeheartedly. So yes, we want a nation that is composed of Christians, okay? You see the difference there? We don't want a nation that's kind of forced down this Christianity path. We want a nation that chooses Christianity. So we got to kind of differentiate that. So this slide right here, America, the Christian nation, I have that in parentheses. Once again, I'm not going to go down this rabbit trail, but did we really have Christian founding fathers? I'm not going to lie, guys, I used to be wholly on board with the fact that all of our founding fathers were Christians. I've even taught lessons on the fact that all of our founding fathers were Christians. And the more that I studied and I saw where the truth led, I realized that the founding fathers weren't all Christians. A majority of them were what we would call deists. They did believe in God, but they had a very different view of the God that we have of you. They didn't view God as a loving father who sent his son necessarily to die on a cross for us. So with that being said, I don't hold to the view that we had all Christian founding fathers. We did have some Christian founding fathers, and they most definitely influenced the foundation of our country. There's no doubt that our country was founded on Judeo-Christian belief systems. There's no doubt about that. Now, whether we're still following those or whether they're crumbling by the wayside right now, that's kind of up for debate, but I do believe we are losing our Judeo-Christian roots. It's important for us to remember that men were fleeing oppressive government. The foundation of our country, these guys were fleeing from the state church, the Church of England. That literally the foundation of America was fleeing a state church. You guys have to keep that in mind. America is a unique experiment. It's never been before where you have literally a free choice of religion. All through human history, religion has kind of been forced by the government. So this idea of separation of church and state, which we'll cover down the road when we get to the Church of Philadelphia, is it really important for us to remember that this, what happened in America's founding, is completely unique. And it's a miracle and it's a blessing of God, this separation of state and church. But what you guys are going to see, when you have this separation, you can choose any religion you want, right? That's the freedom of religion. That's what we're founded upon. And to be honest with you, that's what's kind of becoming under attack today. The two big things that we really need to stand for as Americans, well, and there's more than two, but especially in wake of the things that are happening in the nation today, is freedom of religion and freedom of speech. Those two are huge rocks, and they are massively under attack right now. So it's important for that to be in our prayers and to be paying attention to what's going on. Has America, so, you know, once again, we're looking at in terms of, do we really want to be lumped in as known as a Christian nation, right? Has America reflected over the last 100 years the life and teachings of Jesus? One could definitely make an argument that we haven't, right? We are the number one exporter of good, but we are also the number one exporter of evil. So think about that for a second. Of course, you know, we're exporting the gospel for 100 years and more. We've exported the gospel of Jesus Christ. We've printed Bibles, so on and so forth. But on the other end of the spectrum, because we have this freedom, we're also the number one exporter of evil. We've infected the world with pornography. We've infected the world with greedy capitalism. And I'm not an anti-capitalist, by the way. But it's just important for us to realize, but here's what you guys got to get. The good and the evil, this is kind of a picture of human nature. Because America has freedom, you are going to see good and evil, right? But of course, government is supposed to suppress evil, right? And it's supposed to try to control the evil. But when you have men who have free will, we're going to see both the good and the evil. So just important for us to think about. So there is no doubt that America has been blessed, right? There's no doubt. When you read the statistics that I can't remember exactly, but more than 70% of the world lives on less than $2 a day, right? We are a blessed nation. Even our poor that are living what we would consider less than average are rich, okay? This country is blessed. If you've ever done a mission trip or gone to a third world country, you've experienced this firsthand. I remember the first time when me and Melissa did our first mission trip, we went to Jamaica, you know, we were thinking it was going to be kind of like a beach resort, kind of like everything's real happy. And yeah, that's in the touristy areas, right? Everything's real nice because that's where the money is. You go outside anywhere else on that island, it's total poverty. People are living in our average closet size over here in America. They live in little metal sheds, right? No doubt we are blessed. So Anytime you can take a missions trip like that, I highly recommend it because it puts your life and it puts your blessings in perspective. Mm-hmm. Anyways, what is the real reason for America's blessings? I'll give you guys a few of why I believe America has been so blessed. Genesis 12:3, God says to Abraham, he says, I will bless those who bless you and curse those who curse you. I'm one of those crazy fundamentalist Christians that believe when God told Abraham that if you are good to the people Israel, that God is going to bless you. I believe that America has been one of the greatest allies of Israel since its foundation in 1948 and even before then. So it's important for us to remember that I believe many of our blessings are because of the way we treated Israel. Now that should also cause us to really pay attention to what's going on with our country now and what's going on in the news right now as we begin to slowly turn our back on Israel, if we haven't already, because that's going to be taking away some of the blessings that I believe God has given us. Another reason for our America's blessing is because men began to take the Word of God literal and seriously. We saw that in the foundation of this country. You guys are going to see that this time period coincides with the Philadelphian church, which we know the Philadelphian church is the church of brotherly love. We all want to be the Philadelphian church. But these guys took the Word of God literal, okay? And you guys got to understand, remember, they're fleeing. These men were fleeing from a state church. So now because they're reading the Bible and they're taking it literal, they proclaimed the gospel. So one of the reasons why America was blessed from the beginning is because they took the Word of God literal and they began to preach the gospel to anyone who would listen. Anytime that we as a church are active in preaching the gospel, we're going to be blessed. Jesus said, go make disciples. He's going to bless you. You're basically, as long as we're walking in the Father's will and we are evangelizing, I believe we're invincible. Okay, and T. Hood is an example of this. If you guys, when we see all the details of Tyler's wreck, you guys will see that Tyler probably should have died this week. Okay, but T. Hood is actively evangelizing. He's actively following God's will, and God's not finished with him yet. Right? He walked away miraculously. I heard from a police chief. I heard from a nurse. I heard from an EMT that anybody who walked away from this was an absolute miracle, especially to have no broken bones. So anyways, I'm just kind of giving you guys a picture. God will take care of us. We follow His will. We follow His dictates. He knows the end from the beginning for us, right? So that's important for us to remember. Also, the reason why America is blessed is because, once again, when you take the Word of God literal, what do men do? What do women do? They pray, right? When I read in Scripture where in the Old Testament, God says, pray for the peace of Jerusalem, I take that literal, and I begin to pray for the peace of Jerusalem, right? So why was America so blessed? Because people were praying for America. They were praying for blessing. They were praying. They were asking. And once again, we looked at this a couple weeks ago, but is America, the American church, still praying? Not really. Not necessarily. We've lost that kind of literal application. We've lost that power. We've lost that our number one weapon of change. You know, if we're tired of where we're at in America, the number one weapon that we have that we can fight anywhere is prayer. So it's important for us to remember.
And remember last week we showed the statistics that it's only, I think it was like right at 50% of the
one church. Out of every two.
Yep, prays every day. So
imagine only one out of every two Christian taps into the source of life, right? Taps into our greatest resource. Also, another reason for the blessing of America was God was creating a safe haven for His people. If you guys look at the world the Jewish population, I don't know the exact statistics, but somewhere around there's somewhere around 8 or 9 million over in Israel now. America has the second biggest Jewish population, somewhere approximately 6 or 7 million. But all during the entire Holocaust times, during all the times when the Jews were persecuted, the Jews found a safe haven over here in America. And once again, I take that promise that God gave Abraham literal. Anybody who blesses the American people, God will continue to bless them. You guys have to understand that God's not done with Israel. He's saving a remnant of people. Eventually, all these people, all these Jews, even the Jews in America, I think, if you guys aren't seeing that Jewish persecution is on the rise again, you're not reading the headlines. But as we see this persecution rise, you're going to see the Jews go more to Jerusalem. It's called Aliyah. They're going to move back to the homeland. God's going to allow persecution to happen. He's going to get the Jews back over in Jerusalem. which is setting the stage, guys, for the big end time battle that we're going to see, the Antichrist versus Israel.
And that article you posted about the rabbi saying the Messiah is coming back soon, it goes on to talk about how Jews are flowing into Israel right now.
At an unprecedented rate. Mm-hmm. And what that gets us excited as believers in Christ, because once again, I believe that we are out of here before the seven-year tribulation. I hold to a pre-tribulational rapture. So if we're seeing signs forming that that we know that these wars that are going to happen during the seven-year tribulation are getting closer and closer, how much closer is the rapture, right? And once again, that's why it's just, we're excited. Number 14, we're almost done. We must address the millennial issue and take a stand. So application number 14, you guys still got room on your paper? We running low? We must address the millennial issue. Okay, guys, I didn't realize how huge this millennial issue is. That the previous slides that we went over with understanding the state church was just background for you guys to really grasp this, because this is where we're going with this. The millennial issue, you guys don't even understand it yet, and I'm not saying that in a derogatory sense, but you guys will see that this is an issue that the church has to face right now, and we'll look at this. So, it's a just real quick review. There are differing views of the millennial kingdom, okay? There's a premillennial view that believes that Jesus is literally going to come back before what's known as the millennial reign of Christ. The millennial reign is a 1,000-year period in history where Jesus is going to rule and reign from the earth. Now, how that works out is where the X factor is here. So, there are those of us who hold to a premillennial view, meaning Jesus comes back, the church is with him, and we rule and reign with Christ for a literal 1,000 years here on this earth, okay? And we'll discuss that more as we get to further down the road of Revelation, but we're just getting a basic understanding here. There's also the view of postmillennialism, which teaches that Jesus will return at the end of the 1,000 years, and what that looks like. You guys got to understand, I'm gonna paint with broad strokes here, okay? There are many different segments or sects, S-E-C-T-S, of postmillennialism. They all have a little bit different twist, but I'm going to kind of paint them in broad strokes just so we kind of get a basic understanding. But postmillennialists believe that the 1,000-year golden rule, the reign of Christ, will happen, and the church will still be down here. Well, they'll actually be ruling and reigning with Christ through the church, and we'll talk about that. That's kind of what the postmillennials view. And then you also have the amillennial view, which literally says that the 1,000 years is just an allegory. There really is no literal 1,000 years. It's just a time period that the Bible uses as an allegory. So, with that being said, remember all the way back. How long have we been going? Almost a year?
Almost
a year. So almost a year ago, I told you guys and we laid out helpful eschatological tips. So when you're studying prophecy, what is the best ways to really hash out what God's Word is saying, right? The number one golden rule of interpretation, and I didn't make this up. This is from leading theological professors who study the Word of God. Know the golden rule. When the plain sense of Scripture makes common sense, seek no other sense. So you read God's Word. When it says, you know, people are going to take a mark, you take that as it's going to be a literal mark. Okay, you just take God's Word, what it says. Therefore, take every word at its primary, ordinary, usual, literal meaning, unless the facts of the immediate context indicate clearly otherwise. For instance, in the book of Psalms, I believe it says, God has feathers, right? Or God will protect, he'll hide you under his wings, okay? That obviously is a metaphor, and it's obvious that he's describing his covering, but that doesn't necessarily mean that God is a bird, right? So we have to be able to understand the uses of similes and metaphors, but that doesn't mean that when I read a sentence, I just get to make it say whatever I want it to say. We have to take it literally, okay? So I want to go ahead. Chuck Misler always says, God says what he means, and he means what he says. We have to be extremely careful when we begin to allegorize the Scriptures and we kind of make it say whatever we want it to say. We're actually poking God in the eye in a lot of instances. So God says what he means, and he means what he says. Let's look at this. So guys, this set of verses right here, just so you know, is some of the most controversial sets of Scripture in the New Testament, okay, in the church today. Theologians will battle tooth and nail over this. And I just want to simply read it real quick and kind of go over with you how simple a literal view of this is, okay? Revelation 20, and obviously we've already covered a lot of this, and we're going to cover this in the future, but Revelation chapter 20 says, "And I saw thrones, and they sat on them, and judgment was committed to them. Then I saw the souls of those who had been beheaded for their witness to Jesus and for the word of God." Those souls there, we believe, are the tribulation saints who will be killed during the tribulation, but that's a side note. Who had been beheaded for their witness to Jesus and for the word of God, who had not worshipped the beast or his image, and had not received his mark on their foreheads or on their hands. And they lived and reigned with Christ for 1,000 years. But the rest of the dead did not live again until the 1,000 years were finished. This is the first resurrection. Blessed and holy is he who has part in the first resurrection. Over such the second death has no power, but they shall be priests of God and of Christ, and shall reign with him for 1,000 years. Okay, simple, right? When I read that as we are going to rule and reign with Christ for 1,000 years. You don't have to dance around it. You don't have to create any kind of fancy interpretation. I take it to mean 1,000 years, okay? And that seems simple enough for us, you know, to get. But I'm going to show you right now some of the differing views of this. And if you have a differing view of this, I want to show you guys where it leads, because it leads us to some extremely dangerous conclusions, and I'll show you what that means. So let's take a look at some dangers of mishandling the millennium. Did Jesus already set up his earthly kingdom through the church? Those who hold a post-millennial view or an amillennial view literally believe that Jesus has already set up his earthly kingdom through the church, okay? Let me just go ahead and read this for you. This is from the Catechism of the Catholic Church, article number 551. So a catechism is basically like this is, so if we had a book of doctrines of First Assembly of God, or would it be Protestant? Either way. But what I'm saying is it's a teaching, it's basically scholars of the Catholic Church have laid out what the doctrines of the Catholic Church are.
And they take this to be infallible too.
Absolutely. From the beginning of his public life, Jesus chose certain men, 12 in number, to be with him and to participate in his mission. He gives the 12 a share in his authority and sent them out to preach the kingdom of God and to heal. They remain associated forever with Christ's kingdom, for through them he directs the church. As my Father appointed a kingdom for me, so do I appoint you that you may eat and drink at my table. This is a quote from Scripture, by the way. Let me start that over. As my Father appointed a kingdom for me, so do I appoint for you that you may eat and drink at my table in my kingdom and sit on thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel. Okay, so first and foremost, I want you guys to get, they believe that the millennial reign of Christ was instituted already. It began, and it began through the church. And basically, this upper priest class kind of dictates how the church functions and how things are going. But notice that verse they use from Luke 22. As my Father appointed a kingdom for me, so I also appoint it to you, and you will sit on the thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel. If you go back and read that from Luke 22, Jesus is talking to the 12 disciples. Once again, I take that literal. He's teaching the 12 disciples that in the future millennial reign, they are going to rule over Jews in the millennial kingdom. Literal, the 12 tribes of Israel. You take that literal, right? The Catholic Church has allegorized this, and they're basically saying that the church, this isn't talking about a future reign of Christ. This is talking about a reign right now. Basically, the church gets to judge right now, and these 12 tribes of Israel is allegoric for the church, okay? So they've allegorized that. Look at another one. Article number 553. The power to bind and loose connotes the authority to absolve sins, to pronounce doctrinal judgments. Okay, guys, remember when we went over Matthew 16 and Jesus, the foundation of the church, he said, "On this rock I will build my church." And he talks about binding and loosing. They teach that this binding and loosing means that the church is in charge of teaching what is proper doctrine and then enforcing that, okay? Now, I do believe that we need to teach proper doctrine, but I don't get to force my doctrine on anyone, okay? I hold to a premillennial view. I don't get to force my premillennial view on a postmillennialist. Catholics believe that if you don't believe the doctrines of the church, you're apostate, Okay? Basically, you're not saved.
Yep.
Okay? You're accursed. It's called anathema. So they believe that when God said that you have the power to bind and loose, he's saying that the church is the final authority on doctrines. And if you don't believe the doctrines that the Catholic Church teaches, you're anathema. You're not saved. I know a lot of Catholics don't like to discuss this, but you and I sitting in this room, because we don't hold the certain views that they do, we are cursed. We are anathema. We are going to hell because we don't necessarily believe the same doctrines they do. And I know that that gets real hairy. Jesus entrusted this authority to the church through the ministry of the apostles, and in particular, through the ministry of Peter, the only one to whom he specifically entrusted the keys of the kingdom. Once again, guys, the Catholic Church, they believe that the foundation of the church was on Peter, and they believe that he was the first, quote, pope, okay? So they believe in what's called apostolic succession that goes all the way back to Peter, and so you always have this infallible leader over the church, and he decides what goes on with the church. He's the one who dictates doctrines. He's the one who dictates what's going on in the world. Remember when we went over the Pope and he gave this whole green agenda just recently? So the Pope acting as on behalf of the church, you guys got to understand that we don't believe that the rock that Jesus was talking about there was Peter. We believe that the rock that he was talking about was Jesus. The church is built upon Jesus, not upon a man. Okay, so that's important for us to remember. Article 567, the kingdom of heaven was inaugurated on earth by Christ. And by the way, guys, anytime you read in Scripture, kingdom of heaven, it's not always the same thing. You have to learn the context of reading what the kingdom of heaven. Actually, it could be translated kingdom of heaven, or it could be translated kingdom from heaven. The context is what determines what this is talking about. There are multiple times in Scripture when you read kingdom of heaven, it's talking about the literal thousand-year millennial reign of Christ that happens. Okay, so it's important for us to differentiate that. On earth by Christ, the kingdom shown out before men in the world in the works in the presence of Christ. The church is the seed and the beginning of this kingdom. Its keys are entrusted to Peter. Okay, so long story short, the Catholic Church believes that this millennial reign of Christ has already begun. We're in it right now, just so you guys know, according to Catholic doctrine. The millennium that we read from that verse in Revelation is just an allegory. Jesus isn't necessarily going to come back and set up a thousand-year millennial reign. Will there be a Christian New World Order? This kind of goes along with our intro there. I find it interesting when I find pictures on the internet. So notice, by the way, isn't it ironic that the Pope is going around preaching that the wealthy need to give up their wealth? I'm sure that the Vatican is going to line up and they're going to give away all their gold, right? And they're going to give away the billions of dollars of wealth that the Catholic Church has, right? I'm sure they're going to give that to all these poor nations.
Well, just a typical day the Pope walks around in like hundreds of thousands of dollars worth of garb,
right,
basically.
Right. And I always find it interesting when we find these world summits and these actors and these popes and these people that come and they say that, hey, you guys are polluting the earth. You need to stop. Okay, while they're flying in their private jets, you know, using up fossil fuels, but we're the bad ones, right? Anyways, there's a little side tangent for you. But notice there on the plane, I find this extremely interesting. Notice I highlight that there. Underneath the Vatican's little coat of arms up there, you see a picture, and what does it say? One world, right? Right there on the Pope's plane. Guys, we are never going to form a one world anything before Christ comes. Okay, it's not going to happen. And in fact, any formation of a one world anything is kind of trying to reverse that curse that God put on the Tower of Babel all the way back in the beginning of Genesis. So it's important for us to realize that without Jesus ruling and reigning physically on earth, there is no union. There never will be. That's what's missing from the Catholic Church, is Jesus being on the earth to rule and reign. Now, guys, I don't want you to think that I'm going to sit up here and bash Catholics, right? Catholics get a lot of things wrong, but guess what? So do Protestants, right? And just so you know, we are the product of Protestantism, and we'll discuss that more when we get to the Church of Sardis. But Protestants aren't immune to improper millennial doctrine. They fall for this same trap of mistaking the literal millennial reign of Christ. There's what's known as Christian dominionism, and these are the important things that you guys got to have on your radar. Because believe it or not, as I said, this stuff is rising. You're going to see it. You're going to start hearing about it. But Christian dominionism, from gotquestions.org. Christian dominionism is a term coined by social scientists and popularized by journalists to refer to a subset of American Christianity that is conservative, politically active, and believes that Christians should and eventually will take control of the government. So guys, rewind back to what I was talking about, the state church. According to Christian dominionism, they go all the way back to the garden when God told Adam and Eve, take dominion over the earth. They believe now that we as Christians are to take dominion over the earth and rule and reign. We're supposed to set up a Christian state. We're supposed to infiltrate all politics. We're supposed to set up a Christian nation. So remember the difference, though. We don't believe that we're going to force a religion upon anybody, right? We believe that repentance is only through free will. So we won't ever, we don't hold to the tenets that Christian dominionists believe. They literally believe, and this is what you would consider politically far right wing, okay? So right now we're seeing a lot of liberal left ideas infiltrate America. This would be considered the far right wing. And obviously the truth always lies somewhere in the middle of ideologies. Another one is what's known as Kingdom Now theology. And once again, you guys are going to hear this. This is going to be an issue that the church will have to face. Kingdom Now adherents believe that long ago, Satan stole the keys of spiritual dominion when he deceived Adam and Eve. Then when Christ gave the keys of the kingdom to Peter, isn't it interesting, guys, that a long time ago, in one of our lessons, I said that this verse in Matthew 16 was where Satan was going to corrupt the minds of men, and he was going to corrupt give people false teachings about this. This throws men off on Catholics. It skews men off on Protestants. If we don't get the kingdom right, Christ gave the keys of the kingdom to Peter. He didn't just give it to Peter, by the way. He gave it to all the apostles. The keys of the kingdom is basically like saying it's the opening of the door. So basically what Jesus gave the keys of the kingdom is he said, go preach the gospel. Okay, we have the keys to the kingdom. When we preach the gospel, we're allowing people to enter the kingdom, okay? Not just Peter, not just the 12 apostles. It was a sign that dominion had returned to man. Now it is our job to take back what is rightfully ours. That is, to claim dominion over the earth and spiritually subdue it for Christ. Proponents of Kingdom Now theology believe that the capturing of this dominion includes having Christians in political office, plus a return of spiritual power manifested by signs, miracles, and healings. Guys, the reason why this is so important is because, honestly, I believe that there is a great number of, quote, Christians who aren't really Christians. Okay, they aren't really following the Bible. They have never repented. They've never trusted Jesus for their salvation. But they adhere to this ideology. They adhere to the fact that the world is going to be cleaned up, that there's going to be some unity in the world, and we're going to create this utopia on earth. I believe that those Christians who are left behind at the rapture, who weren't really Christians, are going to fall for the trap of the Antichrist, who is going to bring about a one. You guys got to understand, this one world religion is going to combine all the big religions. It's going to combine Christianity, Islam, Judaism. It's going to combine them all somehow, right? So there will be Christians, quote, Christians, who will be left behind, who will gladly join in this movement. And I believe that right here, this is going to be a big aspect of that, getting the millennial right. So really quick, what does the Bible say about our time here on earth, okay, and Jesus' earthly kingdom? This answers it all to me. This answers the question of the millennium to me, and it's simple. John 8, verse 23, and he said to them, you are from beneath, I am from above. You are of this world, I am not of this world, okay? Jesus said that this way this world is working right now, this world system that's under Lucifer, he has nothing to do with this world, guys. And he won't until he comes back and takes it back from Satan. And we'll talk about that in the book of Revelation. John 18, verse 36. Jesus answered, my kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, my servants would fight so that I should not be delivered to the Jews. But now my kingdom is not from here. Okay? This one's kind of a dead giveaway. We read that, do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the pride of life, we covered all that, is not of the Father, but is of the world. And the world is passing away. Do you guys see that? The world is passing away. According to those who hold to a postmillennial view and an amillennial view, the world isn't passing away. In fact, it's going to get better, right? We're going to find some kind of a utopia. We're going to get, the world is going to get cleaned up through Christ, etc. But that's not what God's word says. God's word actually says things are going to get worse, right? This world is falling away until Jesus comes back. That's what we're missing. And this one's the dead giveaway for us. Okay, we're the church age. Colossians 3. If you then were raised with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ is, sitting at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things above, not on things here on earth. Okay, we are to be heavenly minded people. Now that doesn't mean that we're so heavenly minded that we're worthless down here on earth. But everything that we do on earth is through the prism of things above. We aren't going to take over the world for Christ, guys. I hate to break it to you, but we're never going to have a political state church, a utopia where the world is going to sing kumbaya and Christianity is going to be cool, right? I hate to tell you this, but Christianity is never going to be popular. I'm never going to preach a message like this or speak a message like this and everybody's going to be like, oh, wow, I want that Christianity. In fact, it's going to be more and more marginalized. Mm-hmm. So it's important for us to set your mind on things above, not on things on earth. And that just settles it for me. Okay, last one. I'm going to finish it just because this is literally the last point, and I'll fly through it, and then we're done. I'll probably get in trouble for making you guys late, but we're almost done. We're going to fly through this. So once again, guys, we saw in this church period from AD 300 to AD 600, we saw allegory begin to creep into the church. The teachings began to allegorize Scripture and not take it literal. There are so many dangers to allegorizing Scripture, and I just want to look at a few real quick. Some of them are funny, some of them are fun. But for instance, the 144,000. Many of you guys maybe have people knocking on your doors. Okay, has anybody ever seen Jehovah's Witnesses who claim that they are of the 144,000? They get that from a misapplication of Scripture. They believe that there is a subset of 144,000. Only 144,000 people will go to heaven. Okay, I'd say a long time ago that probably filled up, right? But they have all kinds of ways to dance around that. But what I want you guys to get is they get that from allegorizing the Scripture. Whenever a Jehovah's Witness comes to my door, I ask them what tribe they're from. Okay, so you're a Jew, right? Because according to the Bible, the 12 tribes of Israel. You're a Jew, right? So tell me which tribe you're from, and they don't like that. But they allegorize Scripture, okay? So they're not Jews. Has the church replaced Israel? Okay, so once again, when you allegorize Scripture, if we're now living in this kingdom that Christ has already set up, God's done with Israel. Just so you know, the fact that Israel is over in the land right now is just a coincidence. God's done with Israel. He's done with the Jews. There's no such thing as God doing anything with Jews, even though he's preserved a Jewish remnant since the beginning of time. But anyways, this kid doesn't believe that the church has replaced Israel. Okay, he doesn't believe it either. When you allegorize Scripture, you come to the conclusion that the church replaced Israel. Okay, and we'll come back to that a lot. Does the church have physical dominion now? That's kind of what we're talking about all day. So we don't believe that the church has taken physical dominion. For instance, here's an article. The Christian nations of the world will unite under Christ. They will form Christendom and fulfill their divine destiny, and that is to fight and destroy the armies of Antichrist and be ruled by the King Jesus. Some people who hold the dominion theology believe that we're all going to come together and we're even going to fight the Antichrist. And we're going to, long story short, they've messed up. Can I take the mark of the beast? So just so you guys know, a lot of people right now we've heard the mark of the beast is so many different things. I heard it was barcodes. Now they're talking about implanting chips on us for banking purposes. Here's the deal, guys. We take the word of God literal. You don't have to worry about accidentally taking the mark of the beast. You will never take the mark of the beast accidentally. In fact, the mark of the beast isn't even set up until the middle of the tribulation where we're commanded to take the mark, and it's a forced allegiance to the Antichrist. So guys, don't worry about taking the mark of the beast. Now, I'm not saying I would necessarily go get an RFID chip in my hand, but I'm just saying you don't have to worry about accidentally taking a mark and being doomed to hell. That's not the way God works. That's not the way God's system is. Did we Sunday worshipers take the mark? I got to get out of here. Long story short, Seventh-day Adventists believe that when we worship here on Sunday, that's literally taking the mark of the beast, just so you guys know. And once again, that's a dangerous allegory of Scripture. So that actually concludes the seven letters. We made it. You guys made it. You listened fast today. Good job. Yeah, we made it through Pergamos. I'm going to pray real quick and get you out of here so we don't get in trouble. Father, we thank you for your word, and we thank you that you have given us a spirit to understand your word, God. We believe you. We believe your word, and we take it literal. And we believe that the only way that this world is ever going to be cleaned up is when your son comes and he sets things right. No man can hold power to clean up this world because we're fallen. And only King Jesus can set up his millennial reign on earth, and only he can clean everything up. God, we pray for your continued blessing. We pray that you would continue to heal Tyler and get him back and healthy. God, open our hearts and minds to what you would have us hear today as we go and get more of your word. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Enjoyed our presentations or felt led by the Lord, please feel free to donate at esfirst.org.